All right, so today what we're going to do is expand our use of exponential functions, and we're going to look at optimization involving exponential functions. Again, optimization refers to finding a maximum or a minimum, and so we're going to follow the same steps that we've done the whole course when we're trying to find a max or min, where we're going to find the derivative, we're going to set it equal to zero, and then find those critical numbers, and then test them to see with the endpoints, if there is any, what the max or min might be. So we get to example one, where we have the effectiveness of studying for an exam depends on how many hours a student studies. Can you imagine that? Experiments show that if the effectiveness E is put on a scale of 0 to 10, then E of t is equal to, there's our formula right there, where t is the number of hours spent studying for the exam. Now, if a student has up to 30 hours available to study, how many hours are needed for maximum effectiveness? All right, so again, we're looking for a maximum. Now, before I even find my derivative, because again, as I mentioned, I'm going to find my derivative, set it equal to zero, and find my critical numbers, and then substitute them into my original function and also with my endpoints and see what I've got. Now, many times I've mentioned that it's easier to change the way your function looks before you find the derivative. And so in this case, I'm going to expand this 0.5 over the brackets. All right, and so my function is going to be, let's see here, E of t. I take 0.5 and I times 10. Well, half of 10 is 5. Then I have plus, looks like I'm just going to have 0.5 times t and then times e to the power of negative t over 20. There we go. All right. But now I'm going to find the derivative. So I've just changed the way that function looks just to make it a little bit easier for me to find the derivative. All right, so now finding the derivative, e prime of t. Again, let's see here. The derivative of 5 is just 0. But now we have inside here, we have two functions. All right, because we have our, I guess I'll go with 0.5 t is one function. And then we have e to the power of negative 20, or negative t over 20, is our other function. So I'm going to have to use the product rule here. All right, and so the product rule, I take the derivative of my first function, which is just going to be a 0.5, times the second function. So we get e to the power of negative t over 20. All right, plus our first function, which is 0.5 times t, times the derivative of the second function. So again, we're taking the derivative of our natural exponential function here. So we have e to the power of negative t over 20. That doesn't change. But then we multiply by the derivative of the exponent. Now, I could rewrite this exponent. So negative t over 20. I could rewrite it so if it's a little bit easier to understand, it's just negative 1 over 20 times t. Same thing. Either way, when I multiply it, my derivative is going to be negative 1 over 20. I might as well put that in brackets. All right, so now I'm just going to, well, let's just simplify my derivative a little bit here. So I'm just going to rewrite it. That first term, I don't think that's going to change too much here. So E of t is equal to 0.5 times e to the power of negative t over 20. All right, now the second term plus 0.5 times this negative 1 over 20. Let's see here. I take 1 divided by 20, then times it by 0.5. I got that negative sign, so that's actually not going to be a plus sign, it's going to be a minus sign. And 0.5 times negative 1 over 20 is 0. 0.025. Then I get e to the power of just negative t over 20. All right. So now I've got my derivative simplified, I guess, as best as I can. And so now I'm going to set my derivative equal to 0. All right, and so let's see here. Now we have, well, I guess we'll get 0 is equal to 0.5 e to the negative t over 20 minus 0.025 e to the power of negative t over 20. There we go. All right, so we've set our derivative equal to 0. All right, now what I'm going to do is move this second term here, this negative 0.25, over to the other side here, so it becomes positive. And a nice way to do that is I can just get rid of this, get rid of that, and there we go. So now they are equal to each other. Okay, now next step, let's see here. I want to solve, whoops, I'm missing something here. Ah, forgot my t in there. Let's see here. I'll better fit that in there. Very key. Just wondering where that t went. All right, so again, I got 0.025 times t. Slide that t in there. Same over here. I got my 0.025 times t. There we go, times e to the negative t over 20. All right, now let's see here. So now we need to solve for t. Now, one of the things I can do right off the bat is I'm going to divide both sides here by this negative e to the power of negative t over 20. And do the same thing to the other side. And because it's an exponential function, it can never equal 0. So they're going to divide each other out, and we're safe there. And so now our equation is going to simplify down to, let's see here, 0.5 is equal to 0.025 times that t. All right, now I want to solve for t. And so the next step here is to divide both sides by my 0.025. You put that in there, 0.025. Those divide each other out, and I'm getting a t value that's equal to, let's see here, take 0.5 divided by 0.025, and I get t is 20. 20 hours. Now, I got to go back up to the question again here, though. And it says, if a student has up to 30 hours available to them. And of course, I threw in this, check endpoints. So that means I got to check out three values. All right, so in my original function, which again is, let's go back up here. There it is, e of t equals 5 plus 0.5 times t times e to the power of negative t over 20. All right, I have to substitute into that function three t values. First of all, 0. Somebody could study 0 hours, which isn't a good call. Now, I did substitute into the original equation, and I got an effectiveness of 5, because again, it was on a scale of 0 to 10. So I guess no studying, they must be a good student, but they still, if they did no studying, they get an effectiveness of 5. Now, e, I plugged in 20. The value we got from finding our derivative and setting it equal to 0. And I got an effectiveness of 8.7. A lot better. Now this student has up to 30 hours of studying. So there's another endpoint. All right, now I plugged that value into our original function and I got 8.3. And so in this case, with this study, I can say that, therefore, 20 hours of studying will result in a maximum effectiveness. Rating of 8.7 out of 10. There we go. So I guess you could study too much. One of my old roommates in university said his memory was like a cup of water. You can only pour so much in, and then once you keep pouring it in, some spills off the side. So maybe that's what's happening in this case. All right. Now, I'm going to step it up here, a little bit of a tougher question here. Example two, get into a little business here, economics. Is that a mathematical consultant determines that the proportions percent of people who will have responded to the advertisement of a new product after it has been marketed for T days is given by that equation right there. The area covered by the advertisement contains 10,000 potential customers, and each response to the advertisement results in revenue to the company of $2.50 on average, excluding the cost of advertising. Now, the advertising costs $3,000 to produce and another $500 per day to run. All right. A lot going on there. We're going to break it down, though, okay? All right. So we're getting, overall, here's what's happening is they have figured out how many people, percentage-wise, will respond to an advertisement that they're sending out. They get 10,000 potential customers, all right, that they're going to advertise to. And for every person that responds to their advertisement, they make $2.50 on them. But it costs $3,000 to just come up with your ads, right? A company has to produce them, and then they're going to charge you $500 just in materials to run it. All right, so for part A, like I said, we'll break this down. It says, what percent of customers has responded after 7 days of advertising? So just what percent? All right, so in this case, this is our original function here, and this function is telling us the percent of customers that will respond after T days. And so in this part A here, what we're looking for is F of 7, which means I'm going to plug 7 into the value of T. So I have 0.71 minus E, and let's see here, I guess I'll write that in, E to the power of negative 0.2 times 7. There we go. And so I plug that value in. And so you have to go E to the power of, well, I got to figure out negative 0.2 times 7 first. Then go E to the power of that negative, let's see, what, hold on here. Let's 0.2, negative 0.2 times 7 is equal to negative 1.4. All right. Then I take E to the power of negative 1.4, subtract 1, and then finally times 0.7, and I got 0.53, which means if I get 0.53, 53% responded. So it must be a good product after 7 days. All right, now it says in B, write the function R of T that represents the average revenue. Okay. After T days of advertising. So we're looking for the revenue. And again, your revenue is how much money you're bringing in. All right, so let's see here. So we got our revenue function. How much money are we gonna bring in after T days of advertising? Now, the first thing is you wanna know how many people are gonna respond to you. All right, now this function right here tells us this is the percentage of people that are going to respond to us. Not the number of people, but the percentage of people. Now, the same idea is that we have 10,000 potential customers. So we got 10,000 potential people that we are going to reach, but we're not reaching all of them. In fact, the percentage of people that we are going to reach are our function. So 0.7 times 1 minus e to the power of negative 0.2 times t. All right, so again, this, for our function, that's the percentage of people, and then we're going to multiply it by 10,000, and that will in fact give us the number of people that are going to respond to us. So if 53% respond to us, and then we have 10,000 people, well, 10,000, let's see here, 10,000 times 0.53, we'd have 5,300 people respond to us. So this is the number of people. But that's not what this revenue function is about. It's how much money we're going to make, bring in this company. So I'm going to multiply it by how much do we make per person? It says $2.50 on average that we're going to make per person. All right, so I'm going to multiply the number of people by $2.50. All right, so again, that 250, this is the, let's go small letters here, the amount of revenue per person. All right, so we got the number of, that's our revenue function right there. All right, so we got the number of people times $2.50, and that's how much money we're gonna make. Now, we get to C, even closer here. Write the function P of T that represents the average profit after T days of advertising. So the profit. Now, when you're talking about a profit, how much you're going to make, so you've got to look at P of T. That's our profit function. All right. We're going to look at R of T. That's how much money you're bringing in minus your costs. So C of T would have to be, let me see here, your cost of advertising. That's our only cost here. So cost of advertising. So we don't have how much money we're bringing in. We just don't know what our cost of advertising is. Not yet. We'll get to that. All right. So our function P of T, profit function, is equal to our revenue, which we have up there, so I can write that all out. I can actually expand this a little bit. So 10,000, let's see here, times, yeah, I can simplify this. So 10,000 times 0.7 times 250. So let's do that. Put our numbers together, shrink this up if I can. So 10,000 times 0.7. Times our 250, I get 17,500. So that's just putting the numbers, multiplying the numbers. All right, so I get 17,500. And then times our 1 minus e to the power of negative 0.2t. All right, so that's our new profit function. Again, I just simplified there. Now, subtract the costs. Well, how much does this cost? Cost of advertising. I'm going to go back up, have a look at our cost of advertising. Here it is right here in the bottom, last sentence. The advertising costs $3,000 to produce plus $500 per day to run, per day. Okay, so that means it's going to cost us $3,000 plus $500 per day, and tease the number of days. So 500 per day. There we go. All right, so there is our profit function. Again, your profit is how much money you bring in, but then you gotta also take into account how much money's going out, your costs. All right, now it says we get to part E, which is really D, I guess, a little misprint. For how many full days should the advertising campaign be run in order to maximize your profit? Assume an advertising budget of 10,000, right? We can't just advertise endlessly. This is check endpoints. All right, so for how many days should we advertise to maximize profit? So we are going to have to take the derivative here of our profit function. Again, set it equal to zero. And then and solve, all right, to find our critical numbers, and then also check endpoints, which we will get to. All right, now, so I'm going to again simplify this profit function a little bit. So the first thing I'll do, let's see here, I'm going to expand this 17,000 out. Hopefully I have enough room here. So P of T, let's see, 17,500 times 1 as well, 17,500. All right, and then minus, let's see here, 17,500 times E to the power of that negative 0.2 T. All right, then I expand the negative sign over the 3,000 and the 500 T. So it's going to be minus 3,000 and then minus 500 T. All right, I can further simplify this a little bit because I can put my numbers together. So let's see here, P of T, again, helps to simplify your function before you start taking the derivative. All right, so first off, I'm going to write this. We got this minus 17,500 E to the power of negative 0.2 T. Then I'm going to write down my minus 500 T. And then my numbers here. So I've got 17,500 minus 3,000 here. So that's going to be plus 14,500. There. Now I've got my profit function as just a normal polynomial here. Somewhat normal polynomial, I guess. All right, so now I'm going to find my derivative. All right, so P prime of T. All right, so first off, I got my exponential function. So I got this minus, where did I get the minus? Oh, yeah, right there. Minus 17,500. E to the power of negative 0.2 t. And then times, because I got to take the derivative of the exponent there, and it's going to be negative 0.2. All right, so that's the derivative of that first part, plus the derivative of negative 500 t is negative 500. So better get rid of that plus sign and minus 500. And then again, the derivative of 14,500 is zero. All right. So I'm just going to, again, simplify my derivative a little bit here, where I'm going to take negative 17,500 and times it by that negative 0.2, just to simplify it again. Then I'm going to set it equal to zero. So let's see here. Negative 17,500 times zero, negative 0.2 is going to be positive, and it's positive 3,000. 500 e to the power of negative 0.2 t. All right, and then I still have my minus 500. All right, now we get to the part finding the critical numbers. So I'm going to set our derivative equal to zero. All right, so that means I'm going to have 3,500 e to the power of negative 0.2 t minus 500 is equal to zero. All right, so now I'm going to move that negative 500 over to the other side, so it becomes a positive 500. There, done. All right, next up, again, there's going to be a little trick here at the end. So we're going to divide both sides by 3,500. All right, and so now I get e to the power of negative 0.2 t is equal to, I take 500 and divide it by 3,500, I get 0.14. All right, now, where do we go from here, right? We're going to need to solve for T, bit of a tough spot. Now, this is something that I did in advanced functions. I also did it in grade 11 math, for those of you who may have been with me. I'm not sure in this class. But when you're trying to solve for an exponent, you take the log of both sides. But when you have an e, you can just simply take the ln of both sides, because the ln is a special function, a special log function, but you could take the log of both sides. I'm going to take the ln of both sides. So I got the ln of e of negative 0.2t. And I'm going to take the ln of 0.14. All right, let's see here. Oh, got to keep extending the page. And so the ln of 0.14, whoops, better put that one in there. Again, this is just, you can put this in your calculator. And the ln of 0.14 is, let's see here, negative 1.97. Now, the reason I use the log function, or in this case, the special log function of ln, is that there's a log rule where now I can bring down this negative 0.2t in front, and then I have just ln of e. Now again, e is a special, just a number. It's 2 point, I can't remember, Euler's number, 2.7 something something something. But when I take the ln of e to the power of 1, by the way, I get 1. That's why we do that. So here we go. So the ln of e is just 1. So I get negative 0.2t is equal to negative 1.97. All right, and so now what I'm going to do is, well, divide both sides by negative 0.2. It's a long question here. And so our value here, our t value, how long we should run this campaign is, I'm getting a value of 9.83 days. But that's not the way advertising works, right? So we're going to have to go with 10 days. Because you can't advertise for half a day. It's not a radio here. We're sending out advertisements here. All right, so there we go. We got 10 days as our value to check. Now, the other part, check endpoints. All right, so here's the thing is we have an advertising budget of 10,000 bucks. Let's see here. Let's put this in here. So advertising budget is 10,000 bucks. So how many days could we possibly run this for? Like, we could run no days, so that's going to be one endpoint. But how long until our money runs out? And again, it costs us $3,000 to run the campaign plus $500 for every day. All right, and that's got to be less than, when they add that up, we can't go past our $10,000 budget. So I'm going to solve for T here. So I'm going to move that $3,000 over to the other side. All right, so it's going to be, let's see here, less than 10,000 minus 3,000, which is going to be, we got 500T. It's going to be less than $7,000. All right, and then I'm going to divide both sides here. So I want to figure out how long I can run this campaign. Divide both sides by 500. And I get a T value here equal to, let's see here, 7,000. That's going to be a nice number. 14 days. All right, so we got a choice here. We can run this campaign for zero, which is not smart. 14 days or 10 days. So I plug into my original function, which I did. I'm going to save you the gory details here. So way up here in our profit function, this is what we got to substitute our values into. So again, we're looking at 0 days, 10 days, or 14 days. And so I put the pump the numbers in, and the profit for 0 days is easy to calculate, is that you don't run the budget, but you still paid for the advertisement, so you're down 3,000 bucks. So you paid to start it, and it didn't work. Then you run it for the full 14 days. So I plugged 14 in, and I got a value that you're going to make $6,435.82. Not bad. But if you run your advertising for 10 days, found out that I'm going to make $7,131.63. And so in this case, for this particular ad deal, is that the maximum profit is reached after 10 days of advertising, given our stats here. There we go. So that was a pretty involved example there. But again, the same concepts when we're finding max or mins is finding your derivative. In this type of case, we had to come up with the function first, but then finding the derivative, setting equal to zero, finding your critical number, and then subbing in that critical number and your endpoints into the original function, and then comparing your values. And then you can find out which one is the highest or lowest. In this case, we were looking for maximums.